Good morning, Eastridge. We're glad that you can join us today. We hope that you're all keeping well. Before we begin, let's just open in a word of prayer. Lord God, we just thank you that we can worship you this morning. We just invite your Holy Spirit to just move within us. Lord, just fill us with your presence and just pray that you would just speak to our hearts and our minds. And just, Lord, pray that you'd be glorified this morning in our worship to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Jen. Jared, it was really great. Let's continue on in worship this morning by the giving of our tithes and offerings. And as you know, there's a number of different ways that we can give to carry on the work of the church here. We can do it through check or e-transfer or online, and whatever works for you, you know, it's great. And again, we just want to say thank you so much for your faithfulness, for your giving. It's been great, and we just want you to know that we really appreciate that. All right, so let's pray for our offering today, and then also just pray for what's happening. I know here in Ontario, in our area, I mean, the COVID cases are really going up, and we just need to be praying about that. So let's just pause and pray this morning. Father, thank you for your love and for your protection, for watching over us. And Father, as we continue in worship, I ask that, Lord, that you will enable us to be able to give to the work of your church, by the giving of our tithes and our offerings. And I know we're doing it maybe differently than we have in the past, but it's still that ability for us to give with thankfulness, and that we praise you this morning for who you are and what you're doing in our lives, and we're so grateful for that. And so as we give of our tithes and offerings today, we do so with hearts full of thankfulness, of gratitude for your love for us and for your care and protection upon us. And as we are entering into this second wave of the COVID-19 pandemic here, I just pray that you'll continue to protect your children and, you know, even our community, and help us to be able to do our part to make sure that, you know, it's more so that we're wanting to protect others, so enable us to do what we need to do, wearing masks and washing hands and those types of things, and then also just social distancing. So I just pray that you'll help us in that, and Lord, that even through this, that you'll give us opportunities to continue to tell others about you and to share, as it were, your love with those around us. So Father, we ask just your blessing to be upon our service today. And for those who are listening, Father, that you'd be able to just speak to our hearts today as we look to you and to what you have for us. For I pray and ask these things in Jesus' name, amen. Well, just before we get into the message this morning, I have an announcement for you. We're going to be needing to elect some new elders on our board for next year. And so we have, as it were, a sheet for you to fill out, and it should be a link there on the site where to go to do that. And again, as we're looking for elders, we want you to really pray about it and to ask God who would be good to be an elder for our church. And we have a profile there of what we're looking for: people who are spiritually mature, who've been attending the church for a couple of years at least, are giving. I mean, you know, just some of the characteristics and things that are there. And so, you know, just take a look at this. You can, again, look at it there on our website, and you can actually fill out and nominations for who you would like to see be an elder in our church. All right, so please take some time to do that today or in this week ahead and be praying about that. Well, this morning, as we are continuing on in our series on connecting as one, we're going to be talking about really connecting as one with our community and how that looks. And when I talk about community, let me just kind of clarify that a little bit, because when we think of community, maybe we just think of the, you know, Stovall area that we live in. But in reality, when I talk of community, it goes beyond that. It can include, you know, our workplace. That, in a sense, is community, because we're there and we're interacting with people. We've moved, you know, to social media, and another amazing avenue for us to, in a sense, reach out to our community. You know, and it can expand beyond that, maybe extended family and things like that. And so when I talk today about reaching out to our community, I want us to really think about that, you know, it's really reaching out to those around us that we have connections with, who we interact with, that we come in contact with. And so that's really what we're talking about. And just let me preface this by saying that part of the sermon that I'm using today is actually a message that I preached about 19 years ago when we were still over on Main Street. And it's amazing to me that truth is truth. It just is there. I mean, it doesn't make any difference. Time doesn't change the truth. And some of the same truths that I shared back then, I'll be sharing today. And as we get on into the message, I'm actually going to be sharing a story that I told way back then, 19 years ago. And we'll be taking a look at that. But don't let me get ahead of myself too far here. But let me begin really this message by asking us a very serious question. I want you to think about this for a minute, and I'll just leave it up here on the screen. If Eastridge ceased to exist, in other words, we had to close our doors for good, would anyone in our community even notice that we weren't here anymore, or would they even care? Wow, that's kind of a tough question to ask on a Sunday morning like this. But think about that. I mean, really, would anyone in our community know that we weren't here anymore, that, you know, we didn't exist? And I'm not just talking about the building, but I mean, you know, as a church, that we just had to close our doors, that we just couldn't be here anymore. And a part of me, you know, kind of hopes that, yeah, that people would notice that we weren't here. But I think if I were to be honest, And it's not just a reflection on our church alone, but I think on churches in general, that the majority of people in our community probably wouldn't even notice. I don't think they'd shed a tear. And you know, that kind of hurt. And I think if we were to go back a number of years ago, and again, we have to go back maybe 40, 50 years ago, where the church really was considered to be a part of the community. Churches were used for public meetings. People would gather, especially in rural areas, come together on a Sunday morning to talk about, hey, how's the harvest? How's this going? You know, different things like that. And so it was seen as really a hub in the center of the community. And when we lived overseas, we noticed that a lot of churches were built right in the town square, I mean, right center. I mean, they were vital and a very important part of the community. But I think things have changed over the years, and that's not the way churches are looked at today. I mean, really, if we were to be honest, we would say that the majority of people today would probably think that churches are just kind of seen as a tax loss, that, you know, they don't want churches around because, you know, of the tax revenue. We won't get taxes from them. And that really, in a sense, we're kind of a burden. We're outdated, and really, in a sense, unwanted in our community. And as I thought about that, I asked myself, why? Why is it that the churches have moved, that people think that way about us? And again, you know, I'm just prefacing this here. I'm not talking just about Eastridge. I'm talking about churches in general. But why is it that the majority of people think that about the church? Well, I think that there's a couple of reasons. And one of them is that I really believe that we are living in a very secular society, that we have really walked away as a society from God, that we, as a society, don't really think we need God. I mean, we're self-sufficient. We can take care of our needs. The government's here to help us out, you know, even through this COVID crisis and things like that. And that we really don't need God. And so we've kind of moved away from that. And I think maybe because of some of that hostility that's there towards the church, we, in a sense, have built up walls of protection. It's kind of like, let's come into the church here and find, as it were, a refuge, a safe place that we can be and really, in a sense, isolate ourselves away from the world so that we can just cope and continue on. And so we've kind of built up walls around us to protect ourselves. And then I think also in recent years, the church has come to be, in a word, maybe like inward focus. It's kind of all about the great show, I mean, I'm sorry, the great service, you know, that we can put on a Sunday morning, and that people, you know, will just kind of flock in to hear the gospel, and we've really kind of put all of our emphasis on what happens inside the walls of the church. And because of that, we've not really reached out and touched our community like we maybe have in the past. And so I think it's important for us to take a look at that. And yet, having said that, we need to understand that this isn't something new that is continuing, you know, that's happening right now. Because in reality, back in Jesus' days, the religious culture of that time was really based on cultural separation. I mean, you had basically the Jewish nation basically wanting nothing to do with Gentiles. I mean, there was this separation, you know, that we can't do things together. And men and women couldn't actually sit together in the sanctuary or in the, you know, tabernacle or different places like that they had to separate. Women would be on one side, men would be on the other. And we saw this even when we were in Latin America, that you would have the ladies sit on one side of the church and the men would sit on the other, and you weren't to interact with each other. And then also, it was really inbred into people that the righteous weren't to have anything to do with those sinners, that they were to separate themselves from them, not to have any interaction with them, and not to, you know, even talk with people like that. And then it carried over even into the area of people who were healthy. You would be defiled if you were to reach out and touch somebody who had leprosy or some communicable disease. I mean, you couldn't do that. And so they had built up these walls of separation, religious and society. And if we go back and think about it, one of the reasons that the religious leaders were really upset with Jesus was because, in a sense of, he didn't help to build up these walls. He didn't go along with this. But in reality, he broke down those walls and he built bridges into the community. Now, let me just give you a couple of verses or chapters to take a look at. In John chapter 4, you remember the story of Jesus talking to the Samaritan woman. Now, just back up for a second and realize the first thing that Jesus did was that instead of going around Samaria, he actually went right through Samaria. That was what Jews wouldn't do. They would actually walk around. They didn't want to even associate with the Samaritans, who were, a mixed breed, a half-breed, really, in that sense, that they were Jews and Gentiles that had, you know. And so it was like, man, you don't even associate with those people. And not only associate with those people, but what did he do? He was out there at that well, and he began to talk to a woman. I mean, really? You shouldn't be talking to women. I mean, that wasn't what you should be doing. And you shouldn't be talking to that type of a woman. I mean, here was a lady who had some pretty loose morals. And it was like, Jesus, what are you doing? I mean, you shouldn't be doing that. But he did it. And then jumping over into Matthew chapter 9, great story. Jesus calls Matthew to be one of his disciples. Now, do you remember who Matthew was? That's right. Yeah, he was a tax collector. I mean, he's one of those scumbags, right? I mean, he was a traitor to the nation of Israel. And here he had called him to be his disciple. And Matthew was so excited about that. What does he do? He invites a bunch of his friends. Who are Matthew's friends? Yeah, some more scumbags, right? Yeah, those terrible tax collectors. And they're having a party at Matthew's house. And some religious leaders come over and they see this. And they say to his disciples, what in the world is Jesus doing? Why is he associating with these types of people? I mean, come on. He shouldn't be doing that. And Jesus' response back was what? Hey, I'm not here for the healthy, but I have come for those who are sick, for those who really need me. And so he was breaking down those walls to be able to do that. And if you back up a chapter into Matthew chapter 8, Jesus comes down from the mount, and he actually comes across a person with leprosy. And what does he do? It says that he reaches out and he actually touches. And hear this. He touches the man of leprosy and heals him. By touching that man, Jesus, is ceremonially defiled. I mean, he has to isolate himself and those types of things. And it's like, wow, Jesus just reached out and he did that. And so you see that he is breaking down all these walls. Now, here's another question for you. I'm throwing a lot of questions at you this morning. Sorry, it's early in the morning, but hey, I think we're all right. What was Jesus' first recorded miracle? Think on that. Anybody know? What was his first? Anybody? You guys know? Doing what? That's right. Turning water into wine. And as he did that in John chapter 2, where did he do it? Was it inside the temple? They ran out of, ceremonial wine, and so he had to change water. No. Where was Jesus? He was at a party, a wedding feast. He was out there in the community. And that's where he performed his very first miracle. And so you need to understand that Jesus was really reaching out into the community, finding ways to connect with people. Most of his preaching was done out in the community. And so Jesus really set this example. And as you get into the book of Acts, you find out that the disciples followed his example, that they were reaching out into their community to be sure that those people could really hear and know about Jesus. On the day of Pentecost, if you remember, there in Acts chapter 2, that's when the Holy Spirit came and filled them with his Spirit, and they began to speak in tongues or languages that people could hear and understand. And there was just this going on, and people were just shook up by this. And it says there in Acts chapter 2, verse 12, it says that the people were amazed and perplexed that, and so they asked one another, what does this mean? How, in other words, how is it possible that these, fishermen and others are able to speak our language? I mean, we're hearing what they're saying in our language. And of course, there's always a few skeptics out there. And what do they say? Some, however, made fun of them and said, they have had too much wine. In other words, you know, these guys are drunk. I mean, that's why they're talking like this. And it wasn't that way at all. And so what does Peter do? It's interesting. He doesn't stay up there in the upper room, but it tells us there in verse 14, then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed what? The crowd. He went out to the people. And he began to what? Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I have to say. In other words, he goes out among the crowd and begins to talk to them about what has just happened, what's going on. And he uses this as an opportunity to talk about Jesus and the gospel, that Jesus was crucified, that he died, and he rose again. And he just lays it out there for the people. And it tells us there in Acts 2 that the people were, in a sense, were almost cut to the heart. I mean, he's like, wow, we had no idea that this is what was going on. And they asked themselves, what can we do? How is it that we can, you know, learn about Jesus? And here, Peter doesn't pull any punches. He kind of comes straight forward to it. And I think one of the things we have to be careful about when we talk to people about Jesus and about the gospel, that we don't water it down. Listen to what Peter says. He says to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peter wasn't, in a sense, what would I say, you know, giving them an easy believism. I mean, you know, just kind of, you know, put your trust in Jesus and you're good to go. No. It was like, wait a minute, guys. You need to ask for God's forgiveness. We've all committed sin. We've all walked away from him. And it's so important for us to let people know that they have this need of a Savior. And so, you know, when we talk with others, don't water down. Don't make it an easy believism. But really, you know, share the truth of the gospel so that people can understand, yes, yeah, I need to repent. I need to say, God, forgive me for the sins I have committed, and to really come and to put my trust and to believe completely in you. And as we do that, and what happened on this day? What? 3,000 people came, you know, to know Jesus. And it's amazing that this happened. Now, I know some of you are out there thinking, well, Tim, that's amazing for Peter to be able to do that, but I mean, are you saying that we're supposed to go out and talk to 3,000 people in a crowd and tell them about Jesus? I mean, I don't know if I could really handle that. I mean, that's kind of like above my pay grade. You know, I don't think I have the courage to do that. Well, don't worry. Because in reality, God is calling each and every one of us to do what we can with the gifts and abilities that he's given to us. And as you go further on into the book of Acts, you actually see that Peter and the other disciples begin to actually just kind of individually go out and talk with people. And when you get down to chapter 3, Peter and John were heading to the temple to pray. And as they're going along, there's this lame beggar sitting over on the side of the road. You can just kind of picture him sitting there. And he's holding out and asking for some money, you know, alms for the poor, you know, that type of thing. And he sees Peter kind of stop. And the guy's going like, all right, I'm going to get some money here. I'm going to be all right. But Peter's basically saying, hey, I don't have any money. But what does he do? Listen to this. In verse 6, he says, then Peter said, hey, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. You hear that? Peter wasn't trying to give him something that he didn't have. But he said, hey, I don't have a lot of money. I don't have any money, really. But hey, what I can do for you is bring healing to you. He is reaching out to this man, showing him God's love, you know, being kind to him. And so he reaches down and the man stands up. And if you read the story there in Acts chapter 3, what does he do? Here's this guy who was lame. He's jumping around and singing and praising God. And people notice. It's kind of like, whoa. How is this possible? I mean, Peter and John, how in the world did you do this? How are you able to heal this guy? I mean, we can't believe it. I mean, who are you guys? How are you able to do this? And Peter recognizes But the people are really looking at them and thinking that they're the ones who actually healed this man. And listen to what Peter has to say in verse 12. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk?" It wasn't us. And as you go through, he again puts in a little bit of the gospel there. And then when he gets down to verse 16, he really clarifies and he says this. He says, really, this man wasn't healed by us, but by faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. You see what Peter is doing here? He's taking the focus off of him and really directing it to Jesus. And I think one of the things that we need to be very careful of when we reach out and in a sense show God's love to other people, we're not trying to be nice. I mean, in a sense we are, but we're not trying to draw attention to ourselves. That's not our intent. It's really to be able to share God's love in practical ways so that they can actually see who Jesus is. Maybe Jesus in us, through that. And so what I'm saying to you is that like Jesus and like the apostles, what we need to do is we need to reach out into our community and share God's love with them. And I think the way we can do that is really just through some simple acts of kindness. And, like Peter, we need to understand God's not calling us to do things that we aren't good at or gifted at, that we're not, able to really do. But in a sense, all of us have different gifts. And all that I'm asking is that use them. For example, Jen, you're a great baker. I know you give us Christmas cookies and things like that at Christmas time. She has a gift of baking. I don't. I mean, if I were to make cookies, you'd probably use them for hockey pucks, right? But it's like, hey, use the gift that God has given to you. If you love baking and you're good at it, all right, share that with some of your neighbors. Maybe make a pie or some cookies or, lemon loaf. I know there's somebody who makes really amazing lemon loaves and shares those with people. And you do that, to your neighbor who's maybe feeling lonely, during this time that they've been kind of isolated. And it's just a way for you to reach out and to be able to do that. And again, some of you really like making cards and writing out notes of encouragement and things like that. And I've gotten a couple of those and they've come at really good times. And if you have that gift, use it. Make some cards. Go through snail mail. The way we used to do things, and send somebody a letter or a note, and just to encourage them. Maybe they've lost a loved one, and you can actually show them, Christ's love by just writing a note to them. Some of you out there are really tech savvy, and you can help out your neighbor who's trying to figure out how to use their iPad. In this day, trying to talk with relatives and friends, and they might be confused and not know how to do things. And you can actually reach out and just help them to be able to do something like that. Some of you love being on social media and are great at it. And so use that, again, as an opportunity just to encourage others by saying things to them and encouraging them. And yeah, let me just say here, in social media, be extremely careful in that. It's so easy to, what would I say, just put out some things that aren't kind, that really may not even be true, and, those types of things, and you can really blast people, through social media. So be very, very careful, in that avenue, that, you think ahead of time before you actually write something down and pass it on. And use it not as an opportunity to argue and to, demean people, but really use it as an opportunity to encourage others. I mean, we're called to be Christ's ambassadors, and so we should act that way, and especially, through things like social media. And then some of you are just like handymen. I mean, you can fix things here and there. Use that. I mean, use whatever gift God has given you to really to be able to reach out and to touch other people's lives, just through doing these simple acts of kindness. And again, remember that as you're doing this, you're really doing it as an opportunity to share the gospel. You're not just doing it to be nice, but really using it as a stepping stone, as it were, to really ask that God would open doors for you to be able to share the good news with those that you're reaching out to. I mean, that's really what it's about. And in that, now, let me just kind of back up for a second, too, because, I'm talking about really reaching out into the community. But don't forget about, the other brothers and sisters, especially people within our church. Lou talked about this last week and how important it is for us to reach out to each other and to encourage one another and, kind of exhort each other, kind of to move on and to move forward. And that's good to do, too. Don't just do one or the other. Do both. But remember that as we actually show our love towards one another, remember what Jesus said there in John chapter 13, verse 35, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." Even our acts of kindness that we show towards each other can really be used, as it were, to show the love of Christ to those around us. All right? So be sure that you do that. Now, some of you may be thinking, hey, wait a minute, Tim, that's great, but I can't really think of, ways for me to really reach out. I mean, even like people at work or, people I come in contact with. I mean, what are some things that I can do? And again, it can just be very practical things. Ask somebody if you can pick up groceries for them when you're going out. I know that some of our people do that for some of our shut-ins. And if somebody's going through a financial difficulty, don't just pick up groceries, buy groceries for them. I mean, just look for things to do. And let me suggest to you a really good resource. The guy's name is Steve Sogren, and he's been around for years. And he actually wrote a book about 20 years ago entitled Conspiracy of Kindness. And he talked about it as being servant evangelism, with this whole idea that we intentionally do things to show kindness so that we can talk about God's love with people around us. And if you go on his website, kind of dig down through, I think there was one place where he had 80 different things or something that we can do individually or even as a church, as a community of believers together to be able to reach out to people. And it's interesting because this is what I was actually talking about 20 years ago. Steve Sogren has been around that long, and just reaching out and touching people's lives. And in his book entitled Conspiracy of Kindness, he actually told a true story. And what I did way back then, and I want to share that same story with you today, it's from his book, it's a true story that happened to him and his church. And what I did was, I instead of just reading the story to you, I actually went and had a couple of people in the church be actors. And we took pictures of it and kind of put it along with the story. But here, let me just ask for your grace, okay? Because remember, this is a story from 19 years ago, almost 20 years ago. And I was using a high-end Kodak digital 1.6 megapixel camera, all right? And you're probably thinking, oh man, yeah, they had digital cameras that far back. So the pictures may not be perfect, and Tara's actually going to be showing them, not on the screen here, but just for you to take a look at. And so I want you to look at this story, listen, and just see, what God is saying through it. All right, so let's listen to this story. It was a typical hot, humid summer day in Cincinnati. Joe Delaney and his 8-year-old son were in the backyard playing catch. As the two lobbed the ball back and forth together, Joe could tell something was on Jared's mind. At first, they talked about Red's baseball, friends, and summer vacation. Then the conversation took a more serious turn, and Joe felt like a backyard player who suddenly found himself in the major leagues. "Dad, is there a God?" Joe had the same helpless feeling he experienced on the high school baseball team when he lost sight of a fly ball in the blazing sun. He didn't know whether to move forward, backwards, or just stay put. A string of trite answers raced through his mind. In the end, Joe opted for honesty. "I don't know, Jared." Joe's agnosticism failed to stifle his son's curiosity. Jared dug a little deeper. "If there is a God, how would you know him?" "I really have no idea, Jared. I only went to church a couple of times when I was a kid, so I don't know a lot about those kinds of things." Jared seemed deep in thought for a few minutes as the game of catch continued. Suddenly, he headed for the house. "I'll be right back," he yelled over his shoulder. "I have to get something." Jared soon returned with a Mylar helium balloon fresh from the circus, along with a pen and index card. "Jared, what in the world are you doing?" Joe asked. "I'm going to send a message to God. Airmail." And the boy earnestly replied. Before Jared could protest, his son had started writing. "Dear God," Jared wrote on the index card, "if you are real and if you are there, send people who know you to Dad and me." Joe kept his mouth shut, not wanting to dampen his son's enthusiasm. "This is silly," he thought, as he helped Jared fasten the card to the balloon string. "But God, I hope you're watching," he added to his silent petition. After Jared let go of the balloon, father and son stood with their faces to the sky and watched it sail away. A couple of days later, Joe and Jared pulled in to the free car wash that our church was holding as part of our outreach into the community on that particular Saturday morning. "How much?" Joe asked. "It's free," I told him. "No strings attached." "Really?" Joe exclaimed. He seemed intrigued with the idea of getting something for nothing. "But why are you doing this?" "We just want to show God's love in a practical way." It was as if that simple statement opened a hidden door to Joe's heart. The look on his face was incredible. "Wait a minute. Are you guys Christians?" "Yeah, we're Christians," I replied. "Are you the kind of Christians who believe in God?" I couldn't help but smile. "Yes, we're that kind of Christians." After directing a big grin at Jared, Joe proceeded to tell me the story of releasing the helium balloon with its message only days earlier. "I guess you're the answer to one of the strangest prayers God's ever received. Dear God, if you are real, and if you're there, send people who know you to Dad and to me." I am sure there are a number of people in our community who are probably asking that very same prayer. "God, if you're real, if you're there, send people who know you." We have that opportunity to really reach out and to let people know that God is real, that he is here, that he's able to help even in these troubling and difficult times. But they're not going to know unless we reach out to them. So this morning, I want us to pray. And maybe you're out there and you're one of those who are really looking for God and wanting to know if he is real. And I want you to know, yes, he is real. He is here. He's able to come and, in a sense, to meet your needs. You just need to turn to him. Let him know that you are sorry for the sins you've committed, and you want him to come into your life and to forgive you and to allow this new relationship to start with him. I mean, you can pray this morning and ask him to do that. And for those of you who know Jesus and, you know, within our church family, please, let's do all that we can just to reach out to those around us. So let me pray for you today. Father, thank you that when Jesus came, he set the example for us. That he is the one who really reached out into his community, into those people around him. And he went out to where they were to be able to touch them and to bring them to a knowledge of you. And I pray that you would help us to carry that on. And that as we reach out into our community by maybe just some simple acts of kindness, that we would use those as opportunities to be able to share the good news of Jesus Christ with those around us. And if you've been listening this morning and you don't know Jesus, you know, what an amazing opportunity for you today to ask him to come in and to be your Savior, to say, God, I'm sorry for those things that I've done and how I've rejected you and turned away from you. I ask you to forgive me and to come into my life. And I put my trust completely in you. I ask you to be my Lord and my Savior. And I just want to turn my life over to you and ask you to be able to really come in and change me. Thank you that as we do confess our sins, it tells us that you come in and you forgive us and you clean us up and you give us a new start. You make us new creatures, and we're so grateful for that. And for those of us who know you, Jesus, I pray that you will help us just to be faithful to you in reaching out and touching those around us. I mean, looking for little ways just to share your love. I'm cutting somebody's grass or shoveling some snow. We're getting into that season now. I mean, those types of things just enable us. But as we do that, to realize that we're doing it so that we can find opportunity to tell others about you. And so, Father, we just ask, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts today, encourage us, and enable us to accomplish what you've asked of us to do. For I pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Jen and Jared.
We don't need to worry about if we're doing things the right way and perfectly. We just need to place everything in God's hands because he is our way maker. It is our job to be the light in the darkness because God has placed his light in our hearts. And so we need to let our light shine. So let's sing about God as our way maker.
Worship you.
It's really God who does the work. We're just, in a sense, to be His hands and His feet as we reach out and share His love with those around us, that He is the one who does that. And if by chance you prayed and asked Jesus to come into your life today, please let us know. And we'd like to send you some material just to help you along that path now that you're on, and we would just ask that you would do that. Now, just before I close, let me just say I want to thank you to our actors. Did you pick up who they were? Did you know who they were? I think, you know, you saw the old guys and you recognized us. But that cute little guy, yeah, that was Brad Taylor, okay? Keith and Brad. And I did ask their permission to, you know, to show that again. And thank you so much, Keith and Brad, for letting me be able to share that with, you know, our church family again today. So appreciate that. And yeah, great story, and they did a great job. I'd like to close this morning with a specific prayer that I picked up in a devotional that I'm going through. It's from Lectio 365. And I think it really just clarifies how and what I think God is really trying to say to us today. So just follow along with me, and I'll actually have it on the screen so that you can follow along with me. All right? Let's pray. Father God, I receive your love for me. Send me out to love the world for you. Jesus Christ, I believe you live in me. Send me out to show the world it's true. Holy Spirit, I perceive your presence in my life. Send me out to serve the world with you. Father, thank you for the opportunity to gather together. Enable us to go forth in your strength to be able to share the good news of Jesus Christ with those around us. Enable us to truly connect as one with our community. For I pray and ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Lord bless you. And yeah, as you go out this week to share Christ's love with others, may you just be encouraged. And may we just do that together. Blessings and have a great week.